Participation in this conference call is by invitation only. Punjab National Bank reserves the right to block access to any person to whom an invitation is not sent. Unauthorized dissemination of the content or the proceedings of the call is strictly prohibited, and prior explicit permission and written approval of Punjab National Bank is imperative. Please note that this call is only for investor or analyst. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Bhavik Shah from Batliwala and Karani Securities. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thanks, Steven. Good afternoon, everyone, and thanks for joining the call. On behalf of Batliwala and Karani Securities, we welcome you all to Punjab National Bank Q4 and FY21 post-results conference call. We have with us today the management of Punjab National Bank, represented by Mr. S.S. Mallikarjuna Rao, MD and CEO, sir, Mr. Sanjay Kumar, Executive Director, Mr. Vijay Dubey, Executive Director, Mr. S.K. Saha, Executive Director, and other senior officials. I would now request MD and CEO, sir, to start the call with his opening remarks on Q4 and FY21 results, post which we can start the Q&A session. Over to you, sir.
Right. Once again, good afternoon to all of you. The year 2021 has been tough, as you are aware, across the globe, and our country is no exception for that. Tough not only sociologically, but tough even from the economy perspective. Besides the impact of COVID, we also had additional responsibility related to amalgamation of Oriental Bank of Commerce and United Bank of India into PNB. Now, during the entire year, we have also, because of the amalgamation, got certain legacy in terms of the composition of balance sheet, where we thought probably there is a requirement for us to rebalance the same effectively by looking at. So, in the entire year, we have done all these measures which were required. First, technology integration, we finished by November, one bank, December, another bank. Second, entire organization has been restructured effective from 1st of July, which is now functional effectively. Third, human integration, to the extent it was possible, we have done because of the COVID, not many transfers could have taken place. However, later on, we have adjusted in such a way that there's no issue at this point of time. Though COVID second wave has come, which can be taken care of in the next couple of months. So on the front of amalgamation related to technology integration, human integration and business integration was completed. Now with respect to carrying the legacy, we were carrying 50,000 crores over in bulk and CD deposits, which we decided to reduce it. Accordingly, we reduced it to 20,000 crores liability. Around 30,000 crores, 32,000 crores has been completely removed in the liability in the bulk level. On the contrary, if you look at the increase in CASA has been more than 11%, 12% savings, and increase in deposits up to 2 crores has been 19.5%. So it has been a very, good growth in terms of the liability to the extent it is required, because the lending was not taking place in the absence of high demand because of COVID. As such, we have balanced our liabilities entire book in such a way that the cost of deposit will be reduced. And accordingly, you would have seen in the figures that cost of deposit has come down. On the credit profile side, we were carrying a high element of pool outstanding in retail as well as MSME. So the recoveries which we have received during the pool, we did not want to replenish, because the pool during the COVID would have been carrying the stress. So to the extent of almost 6,000 crores, there was a reduction in pool where we did not replenish. Then the other way is regarding the corporate credit as well. Because of high liquidity available, we have seen good amount of competition in terms of interest rates wherever the line of credit was available, and utilization of funds by even AAA rated companies where the tough competition was there. So in that domain, to the extent where we were comfortable, we have gone. Otherwise, we did not move further to provide the price. So these are all the consolidating reasons when we come with respect to the assets and liabilities. And in terms of assets, our growth in retail has been 9.5, MSME has been 7.5, and agriculture was around 6, core retail. Within the retail as well, after the pent-up demand started coming from in October 2020, we concentrated on personal loans, we concentrated on vehicle loans, and we concentrated on mortgage loans more than that. And there we can see the percentage of increase there. In terms of other loans like loans against deposits or otherwise, where the people were required to utilize the money, then it has come down. So overall in the balance sheet, what we have seen is consolidation we have done, and we did not want to carry anything beyond March 21 with respect to any element of composition which we thought it is not required to be continued. Now coming to asset quality, the amount of pro forma NPA at the end of December was 13,000 crores, and in the month of March, April, May, because of the impact on how we have to go about for restructuring in terms of the window available under OTR 1.0, which was given in the month of August. So we have seen that wherever the accounts restructuring may not show much of benefit, we have allowed them to become NPA. As a result, by March 2021, the NPA was around 23,000 crores for the entire year in flash slippage, which contains majority in retail and MSME. This composition also contains roughly 2,000 crores, which would be upgraded because of restructuring. It is a corporate book where restructuring window was invoked prior to 31st December. Now it has been done, restructuring is complete because it is a consortium advance. Whereas in March it became NPA, but that will be upgraded. Further, out of 23,000 crores, already as on today, 3,000 crores upgradation has already taken place across the banking industry, across the PNB country. So, roughly around 5,000 crores is upgradable or upgraded as on today out of the 23,000 crores. Now, coming to the other factors, if you look at the kind of guidance what we had given last time when we were declaring the results for March 2020, we predicted that we should get profit in each quarter and total should be around 2,000 crores. And by March 2021, we booked a profit of 2,022 crores. CRAR minimum we said 12.5, whereas we are standing at 14.32. However, this also will be added by another 30 basis points because of 1,800 crores what we had taken in the month of May. So CRAR will become 14.62 and CET1 will become 11.80. CASA share we predicted at 45%, now we stand at 45.5%. NIM we had given a guidance anything between 2.5 to 2.75, we stand at 2.88%. Global NIM, in case of domestic, it is 2.99%. In case of credit cost, we gave a guidance between 2 to 2.5, it stands at 2.24. That is related to what we have done by March 2021. Now, without going into further details, since I have given already the important figures, I will be open for question and answer section now directly. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Sandeep Agarwal from Naredi Investments. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Yeah, Mr. Sandeep, please go ahead.
Yeah. So my question is regarding PNB Housing Finance. So what is our further plan after this potential issue? What one you want to remain as a promoter and a jointly managed company or looking for more stake sale over a period of medium to long term?
Okay. See, I'll take a minute to properly give you the background before you understand our call. Number one is PNB Housing Finance was requiring the capital for the last 1.5 years and originally estimated at 2,000 crores earlier. That was almost 1.5 years back. PNB is holding 32.62% stake, which is above the regulatory requirement of 30%. So there was a regulatory conflict. We should have reduced below 30%. The communication was given to us in the year 2017. Then for the first time, we have reduced our stake. It got it down to 32.64. At that time, the price was 1,600. Now, after that, the price has gone down. As a result, bank could not dilute to the extent of the required of little over 2% or 2.62%, so that it could have come below 30. Initially, that is one background. Second point is, in the last 1.5 years, when PNB Housing Finance wanted to increase the capital, the first option they had looked at is the rights issue, because from market, they have already selected 4 BRLMs who have given opinion that market appetite may not be very high. Particularly, COVID was also there after March. So this was from October 2019. Their endeavorance was there. Based on the feedback, they initially thought of getting some rights issue contribution, which did not happen. since PNB could not contribute. Then PNB made it clear to them that you should go to the market now for getting the money. By which time the COVID impact also has come. As a result, there was an elevated requirement of capital for them. So under these circumstances, since from market they are not able to get the money, they have relied on the investors existing for getting the capital. These were the reasons for the investors coming forward and investing. Now, from the PNB perspective, we are not diluting any stake. Our stake remains the same, but in percentage terms, it will go down because of the contribution of the capital from other investors. The number of shares what we hold will continue. Now, with respect to what in future you are going to be there, as per the trademark agreement which we have signed recently, earlier trademark agreement was that PNB stake will not go down below 26%. Now, if it was not going below 26%, the sufficient capital was not or cannot be taken by the vertical company. As a result, we have gone for a change in the trademark agreement where we put a benchmark of 20%. So we will not go below 20%. Now, in the new scenario, the vertical position expected could be anything around 20.5 or 20.4. It will come out finally. So that would be the figure. So our commitment to the company remains as on today. We will continue to be the promoter for which we are permitted. And valuations have also increased, which would not have been expected by any one of us. And the company should run effectively post-COVID when the demand is coming up for the housing finance company. It should have wonderful opportunity for lending. So it should be a solution in permanence rather than again going to the market for capital again and again in the next 2-3 years. These are all the important objectives which were discussed before this call was taken, and accordingly this call was taken. So to the limited point of your question with respect to what is the PNB's viewpoint, PNB will remain there. We don't have any plan to exit. Already we have taken a decision with respect to Choice Canara HSBC Insurance Company, where we have decided to exit. The formalities will take place. It is not a listed company. However, valuations will be done, and according to the shareholder agreement, the process will be followed.
Okay. Thank you, sir. That's all.
Right.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Maru Garjania from Elara Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hello, sir. My question is on restructuring. So you've given implemented restructuring of 2,600 crores. And in the last quarter, you had indicated a much higher figure, especially for corporate restructuring. So the implemented restructuring in the corporate segment is around 5.6 billion, whereas last time you had indicated a pipeline of 90 billion. So you did comment earlier that 20 billion has probably been restructured in 1Q, but of that 90 billion, are there many other accounts in the pipeline as well? So what is the total restructured number for the corporate segment, including pipeline?
Okay. See, the restructuring what we indicated in slide number 33 of 2372 is a normal course of restructuring not related to OTR 1.0 as guidelines for which came in August 2021. Now, out of that figure, the restructuring position is just 1 minute. No, that is the same. See, if you remember, our indicated amount was around 9,000 crores in the corporate book, and others together 11,000 crores we indicated. Out of that, in the corporate book, the restructuring what was done is only an amount of around 500 crores, whereas now we have invoked to the value equivalent to 9,000 crores. So out of 9,000 crores, only around 500 crores was done before March, and after March we have already done 2,000 crores. So this 2,000 crores has become NPA in the opening remarks I told, which would be upgraded. So remaining 7,000 crores also will be undertaken before 30th of June. However, in case of accounts up to around 2,000 to 3,000 crores, the response has not been there for undertaking the restructuring, as they think that restructuring is not required, they can continue. So if I summarize everything, as against the 11,000 crores, including corporate book of 9,000 crores, and MSME together of 2,000 crores, overall 11,000 crores, we may end up with 9,000 crores overall under the OTR 1.0 before 30th of June.
Okay, sir. Thanks. And sir, my other question was, what is the total interest reversal on NPLs in the fourth quarter?
Total interest reversal on the?
On NPLs.
That is at the end of March.
Yeah, for the fourth quarter. During the fourth quarter. Not for the full year, for the fourth quarter.
It is 1,277.
1,277. Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
It is a period of 9 months. No, sorry, 7 months. See, proforma.
Proforma. Yes, yes, yes.
You remember, proforma NPA, what we have shown, interest reversal of 431 crores in the provision we have shown.
Correct.
If you go through last time's figure, that yes. 431 is included in the 1,277.
Got it, sir. Got it. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Akshay Ashok from Dalal & Broacha Stock Broking. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, sir. The question I had is the sort of doubt regarding this restructuring. So restructuring of accounts, they need to be standard as on date of invocation or they should be standard as on March 31st, 2021.
So as on date of invocation.
So that could become a problem, right? Because now that the second wave, then there could have been accounts that have slipped in April, May and June. And
if they are not standard,
then you cannot restructure them.
No. Listen to me. Restructuring window opened by RBI in the month of August has two dimensions. One is for corporate through the Commerce Committee recommendations and all other factors are there. Second window was related to retail and MSME. In case of MSME, eligibility was different. SMA 0 and 1 were also eligible. In case of retail, only SMA 0. So considering all these factors, restructuring was undertaken differently. In case of retail and MSME, there is no question of any invocation and undertaking because there cannot be any time window. It can be implemented immediately. In case of corporate, only you will invoke because it requires RP4 rating and all the consortium members coming. That is the reason why there is a window required. So restructuring related to retail and MSME under the guidelines given in the month of August got closed as of 31st March 2021 and whatever restructuring was required we have undertaken. Only for corporate segment we have invoked before 31st of December for the accounts involving an amount of 9,000 crores against which before 31st March we could restructure only around 600 crores and as of today 2,000 further crores have been implemented. However, this 2,000 crores what I am referring has slipped into NPA as on 31st March, but in terms of the RBI guidelines, they can be upgraded immediately after implementation and that has already been upgraded. So the remaining roughly around 7,000 crores in corporate book where invocation is done and the restructuring has to be implemented will be completed before 30th of June 2021. That is related to restructuring window opened in August. Now recent guidelines of restructuring is applicable only to MSME, non-MSME small business and other sectors, that is individual cases.
So these accounts, if they would have slipped in April, May and June, so these days cannot go for restructuring.
Not April, only by 31st March, if they have slipped into NPA, they are not eligible.
Okay. But they should be standard as on date of invocation, right? You told now. So if they would have slipped now, you cannot restructure them.
Then again, listen to me, I'm clarifying to you. Clause of invocation is applicable only for corporate advances. That window was already closed now by 31st March regarding invocation. 31st December, I'm sorry. So for all other accounts, now the second window is only MSME. There is no clause of invocation there. RBI's requirement is as on 31st March 2021, the account should be standard.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks.
Right.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ashoka Ajmera from Ajcon Global Services. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir. Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah, good afternoon.
Take my compliments for overall good performance of the bank, sir. I mean, you have got a very good capital adequacy of 14.32%, good CASA, a very good amount of the NIM in this difficult time. cost to income ratio is just 46.9%, net profit also 586 crore. So some of these parameters, I mean, you have come really very well in spite of all this difficult time and the problems. And for that, please accept my compliments. Having said this, sir, I have a few data points and some observations. Some small points which I, when I went through the results. Number one, in the case of this JST Tengri Bank, which has gone for, I think, action there for the local regulator, the provision in this quarter was 351 crore.
Correct.
And up to 30th September, it was 341 crore. So any more provision is left to be done in this bank, because, or any chances of any recovery out of that?
See, first of all, there is no provision further required. I will explain you both the provisions were different. First provision in September, what we had undertaken was the capital, what we have input in the company. When the company has gone for liquidation, the capital is nullified first. So that provision 100% we have done. Then there was a liquidity support what we had given. We means our branches in Dubai branch has given. So that amount is a liquidity support which is like need to be settled when the liquidation proceedings are in progress. So our claim has already been recognized by the liquidator. No money is to be received. However, as a matter of abundant precaution and prudent measure, we have provided 100% now at the end of March. So right now there is no provision required. However, there will be an amount will be recovered through the liquidation proceedings once the process is completed at their end.
Just a point well taken, sir. Sir, in case of this this fraud provision of 1,013 crore will be now the balance is still pending. So do you plan to make the provision in this quarter or as per the regulation? What is the regulation says? I mean,
regulation is 1/4, 25% you can do in each quarter.
So now how much is left for how many quarters?
See, 1,041 crores or 1,005 crores is the left which we have shown in our notes on accounts.
Yeah, notes number 6, yes.
Few quarters, but it is not a big amount. It can be adjusted easily. In the next three quarters, it will be nullified. Even we can do it in two quarters as well, depending upon the flexibility what we have.
Good, sir. Sir, in case of this new bad bank coming, NARCL, have you worked out of this 84,000-85,000 crores of which has been identified, how much is yours and whether it is 100% return of accounts?
It is 8,000 crores roughly from our side. It is 100% provided. We don't call it as
return. Sorry, not written up, but provided. Yes, yes.
Yeah, 100% provided accounts.
8,000 crores.
8,000 crores is the rough estimate. 7,900 something figure in the tranche one.
Okay, sir. Sir, in the provision, there is a provision of 440 crores in the other provisions. What is this other provisions for 440 crores?
Tengri Bank and OTR.
Tengri Bank and OTR.
One-time restructuring.
Okay, so Tengri Bank has been included here in this. And sir, when I look at the advances, I mean, in the aviation advances of 6,353 crores and tourism advances of 1,690 crores, there has been an increase in this year of this advances in these two fields which are badly affected by COVID. So, what kind of advances these are, and why was the need of extending further to tourism and hotel and the aviation?
Aviation is strictly government guaranteed 1,000 crores.
Yeah, that is okay. Why they fully the six, the entire amount
100% guaranteed by the government? The central government, that too.
Yes, sir. And tourism and hotel.
Mr. Ajmera.
Yes, yes.
Sir, sorry to interrupt, but for any follow up, may we request you to rejoin the queue, please. Thank you. The next question is from the line of Sunny Sehgal. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir. Thank you for giving me the opportunity. So I have a couple of questions. The first question is on the slippages side. So roughly you had 24,000 crores of slippages in 4Q and something around 29,000 crores of slippages in FY21. If you can, sir, give me the broad breakup segment-wise, how much it was in retail, corporate, agri, and MSME, and were there any, you know, lumpy accounts in it?
See, total slippage, our fresh addition, is 25,000 crores in the entire year. Correct?
Right.
23,000 crores in the quarter. Now here, majority is in agri, retail and MSME. Agriculture is 5,316. Retail is 3,441. MSME 9,341. And in other category, it is 5,087. And it is not a chunky one. Large corporate is not very huge.
Okay. So there are no lumpy accounts, if I understand correctly.
No.
Right. And the second question is, sir, I mean, on the guidance on the recovery side for FY22, I mean, how much overall, recovery you are expecting in this current fiscal? And, how much, are any major NCLT accounts that you are counting for recovery as well?
See, in the NCLT cases, not many bigger accounts are left. Only DHFL is there. But DHFL also, the expected recovery is not very huge. 2,827 is our credit outstanding against them, 100% provided. So we are expecting, as per the resolution plan, around 440 crores recovery, which would be a full write back. Originally, we were expecting to happen before June, but probably because of the litigation, it could go and come in the month of, it may not happen in Q1, it may happen in Q2. So in Q1 and Q2 together, we are expecting around 1,100 crores of recovery, cash recovery, where around 6,500 crores of outstanding will be settled. 6,400 crores of loan book will be settled, and the cash extraction could be around 1,100 crores in Q1 and Q2 together. That is in NCLT. Now, we are not estimated for Q3 and Q4. Probably after June, we will have a better visibility because once the NCLT cases also move further. Then with respect to other recoveries, in the current quarter, already we have received recovery and upgradation of 2,300 crores as of now. And we expect another 3,000 to 3,500 crores. So roughly around 5,500 to 6,000 crores we are expecting the follow-up is in progress. If you look at for the entire year, we will have a better estimate of while declaring the results for June. There is COVID impact still we are assessing. Now our approach is, as in this quarter, what has to be done immediately, we are working on that. Once the COVID recedes, we will have a better estimate in terms of understanding for recovery. But majority of recoveries will come in the accounts up to 1 crore because slippage was there in that. And I expect retail to settle down by 30th September and MSME to settle down in Q3 and Q4 because MSME stress will continue for some more time. Exact figures and identification, we will do it once Q1 results are being submitted during next month.
Okay, sir. Understood, sir. Thank you so much. Should I have any follow-up, I will come back in the queue.
Sure. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Jayan Karote from Credit Suisse. Please go ahead.
Can you hear me, sir?
Hello.
Hello. Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, I can hear you. Please go ahead.
Yeah, it's actually two questions. One is if you can give us the SMA 1 number, which we had as of December in the QIP document. And second question is basically on the aging provisions. How much do we expect aging provisions to come through in FY22?
See, aging provision, we will have a little amount in the first quarter, but in the Q2, Q3, Q4, it will be very less. If I have to give a figure correctly, I'll just compile and tell you. Just check it out before we conclude. Yeah, 1 minute. It could be on an average around 1,600 to 1,700 per quarter.
First quarter mein aging.
So roughly around 7,000 crores could be the overall provision required in the year.
Okay, sir. So and the SMA 1 number?
SMA 1 number is around 50,000 crores.
Okay. Sir, but any indications on the stress right now on wave 2? I know it's a little bit early, but what are your estimates given we've had I mean, retail and MSME, do you think much of the stress would have gone through, or do you see another round of build-up now?
MSME stress, though it is still there, but majority of the accounts we have identified. But still, there is an element of restructuring required to be done in the new window opened, which I am expecting around 5 to 6,000 crores. If you look at our MSME restructuring right from 1-1-2019 till 31-3-2021, where that window was opened, our entire restructuring book is only around 4,900 or 5,000 crores, including 1,277, which we have done in OTR 1.0, which came in August. So MSME book, not very high book we have restructured. It is roughly around 5,200 out of 1,27,000 crores of outstanding in the MSME.
And you are expecting another 5,000 on top of it?
Another 5,000 maximum, 5,000 to 5,500. We are identifying the accounts we are following up, but we would like to have recovery rather than restructuring unless it is warranted, because GECL has also been extended now. So we can look at GECL also if there are eligible accounts other than what we have done. We have already funded 12,700 crores under GECL 1.0 and 2.0. when it is extended up to 50 crores, further 500 crores funding we have done. If it is extended up to 500 crores, we could not get many accounts. Now they have removed the cap and added the stress sector. So there we expect around 500 to 600 crores disbursement. So considering the fact that the MSME units functioning, we would like to support them by way of additional funding if they require, and looking at working capital rather than bringing under restructuring unless it is warranted. So we are assessing on that. So that is why our estimate could be anything around 5,000 to 6,000 crores in the restructuring under MSME. Retail, I'm very confident it will settle down, though it appears to be a little high in terms of slippage. For example, our slippage was almost around 6,000 crores are hard in terms of retail, but we expect it to here retail slippage, 1 minute, was 3,345 crores. So I expect retail to settle down by September, because we are able to reach out to the customer. There are incomes in public sector. Majority of the retail is given to salaried class or where mortgage is available. Only in the housing loan we find there has been a delay, but then we'll get the money. So if you ask me straight with respect to the stress, MSME stress is there, but accretion will not be as much as what has happened up to March 2021. We'll be able to handle, and what has accrued also we are confident of upgrading some category. So overall in the year 21-22, we will have a control on MSME in Q3 and Q4. And in retail, by Q2 itself, there won't be any issue. Coming to increase in NPA, there won't be any further increase in NPA. Even if it is coming, it will be offset against the recoveries. That means slippages will be offset against the recoveries. If you observe the outstanding in gross NPA and net NPA, it has been flat compared to March 20 and March 21. The percentage is elevated because of the loan book not being high, which contracted by 3%. Otherwise, to the extent of the slippages, we have already recovered or we have upgraded.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Abhijit Sakare from Kotak Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Sir, going back to the question on MSME restructuring, if you could just highlight why is it that the borrowers are not choosing to restructure or use the ECLGS money to a greater extent?
The ECLGS money, I think reasonably we have given all the outstanding as on 29th of February, 20% of the amount outstanding, they were eligible and we had given to them. That is why 12,700 crores lending we have done exclusively up to 25 crores. There are some people who did not want, there are some people who were eligible only for smaller amounts, so they did not go ahead. But there was a good chunk of people whose outstanding was not there, who were having limits but credit balance they maintained. They were not eligible. But there we are helping them differently by way of any increase in limit is required, because they are in a better position, the account is standard. So GECL funding has happened reasonably. So I don't think somebody has not used. Only question is, when we were doing the restructuring, eligibility is unit should run, unit should have the capability with the availability. So those factors were seen. And if some of the factors appearing to us that it may not be viable, then we have allowed those accounts to become NPA. And we can deal them separately. If the unit is still running, order book is available, we can still fund even if it is NPA. Instead of restructuring only for a brief period and then again it is coming into problem, like what we have seen now, COVID second wave has impacted those which are restructured also. So there we have to again handle them more properly. So that was the reason why restructuring book compared to other banks in our bank has been smaller one vis-a-vis the loans outstanding. In the restructure book 2.0, restructure guidelines 2.0, which are standard accounts as of 31st March 2021, we are identifying. As I have indicated, maybe around 5,600 crores will be undertaking restructuring because they have already withstood the COVID one wave and continue to be strangled. So where the visibility of restructuring and in terms of their capability to come out of this problem will be much higher.
Got it. So second one is a clarification on slide number 14, where you have the rating-wise mix of loan book.
Correct.
There is about 9,000 crores of loans, which is rated D, but still standard. So just trying to understand.
Which one? 14 number slide.
Yeah,
D is, this is what is called some of the government accounts.
A
couple of accounts restructured book standard where rating will continue to be D.
Okay, understood. And so second one was the clarification on slide 37 on the exposure to top 10 groups where we see a 500 basis points jump quarter on quarter.
Top 10 groups, no?
Mistake.
Actually, there was a vertical mistake. Actual figure is 12.93. We will correct and put it immediately. It is not 18.73. It is 12.93. Now we have corrected and put up in the website.
Okay, understood. Just final one, sir. On the NARCL sale that will happen, do you expect to get 15% cash upfront on the fully provided NPLs?
Actually, what happens, our identified book is around 8,000 crores, which is 100% provided. Now, the extraction amount we have to see, it is not on 8,000 crores, you will get 15%. What is the extraction? On an average, if you look at, the extraction is between 25 to 30%, going by what IBC and everything happened, even though real auction will take place by the NARCL through AMC. So, initially, based on each asset, a figure will be arrived at. A reasonable figure that could be anything around 25-30%. Suppose we take 25% as our theoretical understanding, for 8,000 crores, 25% will be 2,000 crores. Out of 2,000 crores, 15% will be the cash. That means 300 crores will be the cash which can directly go to P&L to us. And 85% will be given by us SR, which is expected to be guaranteed by Government of India.
Got it. And the last one is, what is the DT outstanding as of March 31st?
27,000 crores.
Okay, all right.
This year we have reduced 1,400 crores, you must have seen in the balance sheet.
Sure. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Manish Shukla from Citigroup. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon and thank you for the opportunity. The pro forma stress as of December was about 13,000 crores.
Correct.
And for the March quarter, you have reported 23,000 crores. That means addition of 10,000 crore for the March quarter over and above what was the situation as of December. Is that correct?
Correct. You are correct.
So could you give a color on this incremental 10,000 crore where it has come from?
It has come from these sectors only. That is retail, MSME and agriculture.
And within retail, how much would it be secured or unsecured?
Completely secured. We don't have retail unsecured. Even if it's a personal loan given to only employees, salaried class.
I'm just curious because 10,000 crores across retail SME does imply that a very large number of accounts have slipped into NPA after December. I'm just trying to understand what exactly is playing out here.
No, I do agree with you. It is only because of the collections not coming. There's no element of unsecured position problem here. That is why I was indicating retail will settle down by next quarter itself. By September, the slippages will be reduced and the upgradations will be much higher. We have to deal with only MSME.
So given the lockdowns which have happened in April and May, is it fair to assume that the number in the current quarter can be meaningfully higher than this?
It will not be higher because all the collection efficiency in April was 84% and in May it is 91% currently. And June also we are pursuing very well. Though the stress is there, like we have already given the figure SMA2, which was around 32,000 crores when we have indicated 33,000 crores when we have indicated, but it has come down substantially as on today and we are working on that. So I do not expect the slippage to be more than what has happened in March, not even more, it will be much lower than that.
Sorry, sir, you said May was 91%,
correct.
Compared to March, what would it be March?
March was also around 84%.
So May is higher than even March.
Correct.
Okay, fine.
November, December were better. Then January was moderate, January, February. March it has come down a little. Again, April and May it has increased.
Okay. On the asset sale to NARCL, how are these 8,000 crore identified? I mean, if you could just explain what are the nature of those assets?
See, all the assets which are for which there is a value and 100% provided and not declared as a fraud.
Okay. Because you're saying that the recovery is likely to be about 25-30%. So I'm just curious if this is the best, I mean, in that sense, is it the best out of the stress book that you have? And will the recovery in other assets be even lower?
In one case, it could be 40-50. In one case, it could be 10-15. So what we have identified is predominantly not being fraud account. Second is 100% provided. And where all other banks are there. See, first what we have done is above 500 crores exposure in each bank. There is a multiple banks involvement in the public sector space, not being declared as a fraud, 100% provided. So these conditionalities we have applied.
Okay, right. Really the last question, what's your expectation on net interest margin?
NIM, our domestic stood at 2.99, global stood at 2.88, and it will not be lower than 2.75 during the current year.
Okay, sir. Understood. Thank you. Those were my questions.
Thank you.
The next question is a follow-up from the line of Maru Karjania from Elara Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, sir. Just a few clarifications. So the NARCL, in the first phase itself, say by June, you will transfer 8,000 crores, right, on which the recovery will be 25%. As in that the net asset value or the valuation may be 25-30%, and of which you will get 15% in cash. That's correct, right?
No, listen to me. NARCL, while transferring, the net book value concept will not come, because net book value as per the RBI guideline is the outstanding minus provision is the net book value. So here in every case it will be zero only. So it is not the criteria. Criteria is what kind of recovery we can get when we sell through auction. NARCL advantage will be aggregation of debt from all the banks at one location, and the person who will be bidding through the tender process will have visibility in getting control of the asset immediately, protection of value of the asset. These are the advantages. So I had only given an example that in case of each asset, based on the position, the amount assessed. Though ultimately it will go for what you call Swiss challenge, and then only you will get the money. So I gave an example that if 25% is the amount, out of that 15% will be cash, 85% will be SR.
Sure, sir. So and you had said that there's 1,100 crore of recovery in first and second quarter, and that's across two accounts. That's correct?
Not two accounts. There are I'll tell you number of accounts. There are 17 accounts where outstanding will be reduced to the extent of 6,500, and cash recovery expected would be 1,100.
And they are all NCLT, you said?
They are from NCLT only. I'm giving you NCLT details only.
Got it. And so my other question was that what is your recovery from Bhushan Power?
3,000 crores. 3,017 to be exact.
Yes, 3,000.
Okay, 3,017 crores, and it's taken through recovery in written off assets, right?
Recovery in written off, correct.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
No, it is 1 minute. It is not fully written off. It is actually recovery only. It is not written off because it was there in the books of accounts.
Oh, so, but it was 100% provided, right? So, 100%
provided, but not written off.
Okay, so it went through the provisioning line, is it? Or through the...
Yes.
The provisions were lower by 3,000 crores, correct?
But we have diverted provisioning to other areas. Correct. It is a provision right back.
Okay. Okay, sir. Thanks.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Sneha from Shubkam Ventures. Please go ahead.
So, 2-3 questions from my end. First, wanted to know how are we seeing the overall economic point of view and how are we seeing overall credit growth to be panning out?
So, Ms. Neha, if you can speak closer to the answer, please, your voice is
I'm not able to understand properly.
Hello. Two-three questions. First question is, just wanted to know what is the outlook on the credit growth for the next fiscal year. Second is, how are we seeing overall the credit cost considering the stresses coming down both in retail, MSME and in the corporate? So what would be your guidance of the credit cost? If possible, can you guide us how would be the slippages trend going ahead for this next fiscal?
See, economy related, I'll first come to credit cost. Credit cost, our year ended March, it stood at 2.24, where our guidance was anything between 2.25 to 2.5. Similarly, last time when I spoke after the December results, I was indicating to you that the credit cost in 21-22 could be anything between 1.25 to 1.5. Now, at that time, the COVID second wave was not there. Even now, what we would like to stick is probably the credit cost could hover around 1.5 in the financial year 21-22.
Okay. And outlook on the credit growth?
Credit growth, I am expecting at a conservative level 8% because Q1 has already gone, and even though Q1 has already gone, the RBI estimated GDP growth of 9.5% very recently, and the new investments are not yet visible in the system. In the last 1.5 years, we have not seen new units coming up or new industries coming up. As a result, last year also we were not having a lot of opportunity in terms of lending, except people only competing for the interest rates. Debt was moving from one bank to another bank. Not much. Even today we see road projects, some of them have come up where we have given the sanction. In aviation industry, we have also seen few requests for tier 2 or tier 3 center airports where we have given in principle sanction. Not much, but then we have given in 4-5 cases. So unless the investments come into the system, it would be very difficult to visualize at this point of time, except those sectors like cement, steel, and the pharmaceutical industry, biotech industry, where they are growing, but pharmaceutical industry is flush with funds, cash rich they are. So opportunity, what we can see is what they have declared in the budget regarding the infrastructure push. Ports, where government is looking for investment, it should come up. Aviation industry, what government is looking up, it should come up. Then we can see large amount of demand. Otherwise, demand will be there, but then supply will be very high. Currently, supply side is very high, even as on today.
Any plans to sell any of your subsidiaries?
We have already come into the public domain related to Choice, that is Canara HSBC, Oriental Bank of Commerce Insurance Company. We are having ownership in two companies. As per IRDA guidelines, we have to have ownership in the second company only to the extent of 10%. So currently we own 30% in PNB MetLife, 23% in Choice. So that forbearance was available to us up to 31st March 2021. And then we have taken a strategic call to exit.
Hello.
Ma'am, request you to please stay connected. We lost the line for the management. Ladies and gentlemen, we have the line for the management reconnected. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, I was replying to that. So, we have already taken a call to exit Canara HSBC. It will take time. It is not a listed company. So, we will be going through valuations and other things. There is also a shareholder agreement related to right of refusal. So, these things will be taken care of, and we are expecting in the next 12 to 18 months the amount can be received, and it could happen earlier than that, but we are putting this on the horizon. And we have already sold 3% stake in UTI AMC in October, where we booked a profit of 160 crores. We will be selling our stake in RCL around 60-70 crores. We are expecting profit. There is one more company where another 50 crores we are expecting. So these are the plans at this point of time.
Okay. So suppose this recent raising of the capital, any plans to raise further going ahead in the next calendar year or in the end of the fiscal year or anything?
See, as on today, if you look at our capital, it's 14.32. And if you add another 30 basis points for 1,800, what we got through QIP in the month of May, CRAR will stand at 14.62 and Tier 1 capital will be 11.8, which is sufficient. Even if you look at 2% of worst case scenario as in terms of RBI's assessment, still we are sufficiently capitalized. So we will assess the, we still have the headroom for 81 capital of 2,500 crores, which we can raise. Anytime we have not raised because of the market conditions, where because of SEBI guidelines, the prices has gone up. So we have that headroom available. We will assess the position after June quarter results are declared. Otherwise, as per my assessment, we don't require any capital during the current year, even for taking care of the growth requirement.
Okay. And sir, any number you would like to share on the slippages front, if possible? How I have showed, share the numbers on the recoveries front you are expecting.
Recoveries, madam, I said, 1100 crores in NCLT in the H1. And our general recovery generally will be around 3000 crores minimum in every quarter. So we would like to maximize on that because slippages have been very high. So I will have a better estimate when we declare the results for June, because still we are in COVID, where we are coming out of the problem of the collections issues. Now only slowly collections are increasing. So any estimate as on today would not be appropriate mathematically. So June declaration, when we come with the results, we'll have a proper estimate. Otherwise, generally 3000 crores recovery comes in normal accounts, and NCLT this time compared to last year, not many accounts are there. Even including DHFL, our recovery is expected to be 1100 crores in cash, whereas debt reduction will be around 6,000 crores, 6,500 crores.
Okay, got it, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Dhaval Gada from DSP Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Just two follow-up questions. One is on the the national ARC that you talked about. Just in your example, of the 8,000 crore, this will get knocked off completely from NPA, or the amount from NPA reduction would be lower than 8,000 crore. And if I understood you right, sir, you will get 300 crore cash, and the rest will be written down, against which you will hold a security receipt worth 1,700 crore. In the example that you give, is that understanding correct?
I'll split that example into two parts. 8,000 could be some part is written off, some part is not written off. Which is written off, there's nothing discussion on that, because it is completely written off with the provision. So whatever 15% comes, it will go to my P&L directly. There is no further commitment on that. We'll hold the SRs, but SR, since there is no outstanding, there is no provision required to be done. SR also, will be like... without any book entry. However, even if we create the book entry, the amount will be carved to the SR since it is a written-off account. With respect to amount outstanding in the book, so once the cash recovery comes, cash recovery will go there, but SR, because it is also 100% provided, SR will be having the provision which is there against that. So technically, we'll have SR with 100% provided, since all these accounts are 100% provided accounts.
Understood. And I understand. And approximately, sir, of the 8,000 crore, how much is right now in NPA, approximately?
Any figure you took out, 8,000 crores, what is written off and what is not written off? Show it to me. 1 minute. How much?
7,500.
So majority is written off, 7,500.
Okay, got it. Okay. And the second one, sir, on the collection part that you said that May was better than April, is it because of restructuring the collection look optically better, or this is the actual underlying collection recovery that we are seeing right now? Actually, system as a whole, we've been seeing May to be more worse than April. So just trying to understand why the difference.
No, it is only because of follow-up only. There is nothing. Otherwise, it has been very tough for us. But when April was not very good, then immediately we started following up little intensively. That is why we got. In fact, if you compare with other banks also, our position in slippage was little worst or little bad because of geographies as well. If you look at our geographical presence, it is more in north, particularly Punjab, Haryana, and again West Bengal and Northeast. These are the places which are badly impacted in terms of what you call COVID. And the agitation of farmers and agitation of other factors have led to collection being impacted in Punjab and Haryana. And again, in West Bengal as well, the COVID has been very high. Whereas in other areas, our collection has been much better. So May has been better only because of the follow-up, and we are expecting it to improve even in the month of June.
Understood, sir. Thank you and all the best.
Right, thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Sushil from Indus Equity. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir. I had a simple question as most of the questions you asked. You realize the best result which you got out of PNB Housing. You've already highlighted Canara, HSBC, OBC.
Correct.
Is PNB Guild the possibility?
See, PNB Housing or Guild you are talking about?
No, PNB Housing, you tested the result which is being so positively taken by market people.
Okay.
You already highlighted Canara, HSBC, you have a compulsion to sell as per the regulation.
Correct.
PNB MetLife, I'm sure you will hold 30% and you may not dilute. PNB Guild is another candidate where there is a possibility because India is an equity cult market, debt market is yet to develop, and you have such a big retail franchisee, there is a potential to grow that market for retail participation. Currently, Guild may not be able to do it, but views and norms can change over a period of time. So can you look at that too?
At the first level, I appreciate your vertical in-depth understanding. PNB Guild, currently we are not thought of doing anything. We hold 74% as on today, and 26% is held by the market. And because of the changes and the kind of decision what we have taken in the recent times, the market has positively reacted to PNB Housing Finance and PNB Guild as well. Guild also has improved in the market price. But frankly, there is no discussion with respect to PNB Guild as on today. And if at all we discuss, it will be related to expanding as to how they can do the business in the market in the days to come by increasing the variance in terms of doing business. So only after that strategic discussion then we will look at. Otherwise, as on today, we don't have any plan for selling in the stake in the PNB Guild.
Sir, looking at your performance on selecting a nice partner and market rewarding on the stock price, the bank management, the current management which took the Shinna realized the potential of PNB and PNB entity, how you can tap the market and how you can be rewarded where the current market capitalization is concerned. To reap that reward over a period of next 2-3 years, there are any other thought processes on any of the divisions of PNB other than subsidiaries to do something dramatically different than a public sector bank which has been doing?
There are quite a few initiatives we have taken in the last 1 year, though we may not have discussed in the public domain. For example, we have started a credit card company separately. Now, there are two ways of looking at the discussion. One is already credit card market has matured in our country because SBI started in 1998. Prior to that, very few companies was there. After 1998, tremendous maturity has come in credit card as such. If you ask me, you can also say that where is the demand for credit card. However, currently, if you look at our credit card base is very low for PNB. For a franchise of 18 crore customers, a 3 lakh or 3.5 lakh credit card base is so low that within the existing, I can improve upon with the credit card subsidiary. So that is our target which we are going there, where our income from other sources can increase. Second, the MetLife insurance, which we can take it forward aggressively, where the operating income, that is other income from the insurance business can increase because COVID has brought about a high element of awareness in terms of the insurance policies in the country. Then digitalization completely going away from the branch aspect of operational working. So these initiatives are in line with what is taking place, what kind of changes are taking place in the banking industry. PNB is frankly little behind in terms of comparison with our peers itself. If I want to compare with Bank of Baroda, probably we are not able to match in terms of the initiatives what they have taken in the 3-4 years. So we are looking at to catch up with them, move ahead, so that on other income basis, our contribution should be much higher, so that the dependency on NIM is reduced, that is dependency on interest income on loans and handling the liability is reduced to greater extent. That would give a wonderful opportunity for a bank of our size in the years to come.
Sir, seeing that you have 180 million customers in the bank, why is your retail customer base not giving you sufficient business, or branches were inactive in COVID, that your home loans have not even grown by a bare minimum of 1,500 crores per annum?
I do agree with you, whereas the growth was much better earlier 6 months back, because of COVID it got impacted. However, we have completely revamped the organization in the month of July. Now it is working well. We are very confident of increasing the retail and MSME, and particularly the housing segment in the days to come. Already proposals are in the pipeline. We have already implemented even application software where automatic processing, automatic means uniform processing of credit underwriting up to 25 crores is implemented now across the country through all the outlets.
I'm thankful for your frankness on accepting wherever PNB lacks. I wish you best of luck. Let's see, here rewards you on the result.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Harsh from Reliance General Insurance. Please go ahead.
Thank you. My question has been answered. Okay.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ankit Bansal. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Hello.
Good afternoon, sir. But I want to know that, sir, you are in the media saying 6,000 crore profit in FY23. Sir, how come you, please, can you elaborate on this?
See, one important thing is, if you have observed about the provision requirement, what we have done up to March, which was quite high, now we are not expecting that much of provision to be there because NPA, accretion in corporate is reduced, and aging provision is also not very high currently required. That is one area. Then in our slide, if you observe, even though our credit growth has been negative by 3%, our average credit has grown by 2.5% positively. How it could happen is we have removed the bumps across during the periods, and we have got consistency in credit outstanding. We have taken various measures internally with respect to interest rate optimization in terms of liability, in terms of assets. So balance sheet, what it required after amalgamation with legacy, what kind of rationalization it required, that we have completed by March 2021. Now, if at all there is a legacy, it is only one DTA. Because we are not shifted to new tax structure, State Bank of India and Bank of Baroda have shifted in the public sector domain, and some of the private sector banks have shifted. That is the only one which is left as a matter of legacy for us, for which there is no mandatory requirement as on today. Otherwise, the capacity of our balance sheet in terms of credit has got good potential for earning the profit. On basis of these factors only, I have mentioned confidently that our profit during the current year should be around 6,000 crores.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Mangesh Kulkarni from Almonds Global Securities. Please go ahead.
Hello. Hello. Yes, sir. Last quarter, we have mentioned about the opportunities from the sale of some real estate assets. So what is status of this in the FY21?
We have not sold any property which were there in the tendering, but fructification has not taken place so far in the real estate assets. In terms of branch operational, branch rationalization, we have already closed. That means merged 420 branches as on today. So which was a target up to 500 up to June, which we have already done 420, and I am confident of doing that. Regarding real estate, we are yet to get the amounts.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you very much.
Right.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Jay Mundra from BNK Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, sir. Sir, just two things. One is, I think you had given the slippages breakup of 25,000 crore.
Correct.
I mean, if you can repeat, I think the total is not adding up because agri 5,300.
I have given only 23,185 for Q4. For overall 25,000, you can note it down. Agri is 5,460.
Yes, sir.
Retail 3,345.
Yes, sir.
MSME 9,817.
Okay.
And others is 6,380.
Okay, sir. So the MSME is the highest chunk, right? And
correct. MSME is the highest chunk, and we are working on that. In the other category, 6,380, 2,000 crores will be has already been upgraded. That is under restructuring category.
Right. And do you suspect, sir, MSME once you restructure, maybe under restructuring 2.0? Or maybe you do, let's say, ECLGS, you know, the recent tweak which Finance Ministry and IBA has approved. Do you see there is a case for some of the upgrade to standard out of this 9,800 crore slippages?
9,800 crores is not eligible for restructuring. It is only recovery upgradation or if the unit is running, additional funding, but it will continue to be NPA even after additional funding. Until the improvement comes for the recovery. So technically, this 9,817 will remain NPA. We'll be following up for recoveries, or if there is any requirement, we can do additional funding, not through GECL. GECL eligibility is different, and restructuring current window 2.0 is covering only accounts which are standard as on 31/3/2021.
Right. Understood, sir. And the second question is, sir, now the merger has been complete.
Yes.
And I think we have mentioned also that it is very quick in terms of timeline. So now how should one look at it, the cost synergies maybe for the FY22? So you have rationalized quite a few branches and ATM, etc., and maybe the headcount also. So what could be the cost savings for FY22?
FY21 already we realized around 950 crores. And FY22 will be realizing around 1,200 crores.
Okay.
Because branches itself, we have closed around 430 branches. We'll complete 500 by this month end. And another 500 will complete by March 2022.
Right. So in terms of, sir, your cost growth, right? Salary plus non-salary OPEX growth, could we see, so this year we have seen on a YOY basis, it was actually a decline. So could we see that more or less the similar trajectory? I mean, let's say 20,000 crores of OPEX expenses. How should it trend in FY22?
See, main thing is, if you look at cost to income ratio, which has gone down very heavily, there was an exception case in the month of March 2020, when three banks were being merged. In fact, the figures are as of 1st April 2021, after the merger balance sheet was prepared, because of harmonizing the policy on AS 15, that is for funding to pension and other related issues, there was a requirement of higher provision to be made by the merging banks. As a result, the amount was very high. That's why you observe that percentage-wise, there is a larger difference. However, at 46%, of the cost to income ratio, it is sustainable. Even if you've seen December, it was 47% and 46%, which is sustainable. And in the year, during the current year, the level will be same, what you are indicating to me.
Understood, sir. Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, and all the best.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question for today. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Bhavik Shah for closing comments. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. On behalf of Bhatia Rangarani Securities, we thank Punjab National Bank Management for giving us the opportunity to hold the call. Thank you, everyone, and have a good day.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Bhatia Rangarani Securities, that concludes this conference. We thank you all for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.